It can be difficult to decide which funds to use for retirement investing. If your employer presents options for a 401k, the choices can be overwhelming and it can be hard to understand how each fund varies. Which one will be the most beneficial to your portfolio? There are so many options to choose from when it comes to investment funds that it can be mind-boggling. Many don't know much about investing, but just want a stable product that will provide them with the returns they're looking for. They don't want to spend endless hours researching investments. Instead, they want a product with stability combined with growth so they can reach their goals. The most common fund available is one that you've probably heard a lot about. That's the S&P 500 Index Fund. This is the most common indication of how the U.S. stock market is performing. But what is the S&P 500 Index Fund, and is it a good place to invest your money? Let's take a look at what it is and if it's worth adding to your portfolio. My name is Chris, and I help teach people about money, personal finance, and investing. If you're interested in improving your financial future, make sure to subscribe to the channel and hit the like button if this video is helpful. An index is simply a way to track the progress of the stock market. The S&P 500 is an index that mirrors how the 500 largest publicly traded companies are performing, just as the Dow Jones Industrial Average tracks the 30 of the largest blue-chip companies. Because the S&P 500 index accounts for 80% of the market value, it's widely looked to as the best single gauge of the market. That means this index fund's performance is no worse, but also no better, than this section of the market. That's an important detail to remember. Index funds are a passive form of investing. They're a type of mutual fund not actively managed by someone looking to beat the market, but instead designed to mirror the performance of the index, like the S&P 500 index. Due to their passive management, you can own them for very little cost. For example, a Vanguard S&P 500 index fund only charges 0.03%, or $300 per year for each $1 million invested. How does the S&P 500 index fund work? It's pretty simple. If you invest in the S&P 500 index fund, you'll own shares of all 500 of the large cap stocks that make up the index. Those companies can and do change if the S&P 500 adds or drops some companies for others in the actual index. It's also worth noting that the S&P 500 index fund is fairly diversified. It has investments spread out among 11 major industries, with no sector having more than 30% of the money invested. Limiting the allocations to sectors is reassuring when many funds are heavily invested in sectors like financials, industrials, technology, healthcare, and so on. This provides investors with immediate broad market diversification without having to do much homework. Here's a look at the different business sectors that make up the index. Technology is by far the largest sector held at around 27% of the total index. That's quite a bit, but technology is ever evolving and becoming more prevalent. We use it in nearly every aspect of our lives. Secondly, healthcare is about a 14% allocation, which includes companies such as United Health Group, Bristol Myers Squibb, and Amgen. Thirdly, consumer discretionaries make up approximately 10%, with companies such as Netflix, Disney, and Starbucks. The fourth largest sector is communication services, which would include Verizon, Cisco, and AT&T. Fifth is financials, such as PayPal, Bank of America, and Wells Fargo. Sixth is industrials, which is a company like Caterpillar, Boeing, and 3M. Consumer staples is the seventh largest sector, which includes companies such as Procter & Gamble, Costco, and CVS. Number 8 is utilities, which are companies like American Electric Power Company, Emerson Electric, and Eversource. Real estate is the 9th largest sector of the S&P 500, which includes companies such as Crown Castle International, Public Storage, and Welltower. 10th is energy, which includes Marathon and Valero. Lastly is materials, which produce metal, chemicals, and construction materials. You'll certainly recognize some of the big names that help make up the S&P 500 index. These are Apple, Google, Amazon, Berkshire Hathaway, Facebook, Johnson & Johnson, Microsoft, Procter & Gamble, and Visa. And the performance of these 10 largest companies in the index accounts for more than a quarter of the trading activity and overall return. In other words, just 10 companies control more than 25% of the entire S&P 500. Those 10 stocks are huge holdings, so even though the entire index includes 500 companies, they're not equally weighted, meaning the index holds different amounts of each stock. One major advantage of this index is that each company must meet certain criteria to be included. Basically, before adding a stock to the S&P 500, they're analyzed by the U.S. Index Committee to ensure they meet certain financial health measures. To be eligible for the S&P 500 index inclusion, a company should be a U.S. company, have a market capitalization of at least $8.2 billion, be highly liquid, have a public float of at least 50% of its shares outstanding, and its most recent quarter's earnings must be positive. Additionally, the stock must be trading at a reasonable price and have been publicly traded for at least 12 months. In recent months, it was thought that Tesla would be added to the index. However, it wasn't approved for reasons determined by the index committee, but that doesn't prevent it from being added in the future. Should you invest in the S&P 500 index fund? Well, first you have to keep in mind the pros and cons of index funds. Because index funds are passively managed, since the fund just follows the index, they have very low expense ratios, and that attracts a lot of investors. And as mentioned, it's a fairly diversified fund. Where the S&P 500 and many other index funds fall short, however, is the rate of return. If you're happy earning an average rate of return, this is an amazing investment that provides most, if not all, of what you need for a well-balanced portfolio. Although, many people want to earn slightly higher returns by investing in a fund that will beat the market on average, not match it. A good growth stock fund outperforms an index that tracks the S&P 500. If you're interested in outperforming the market, it's possible to do that with a reliable growth stock fund. And no, it doesn't involve individual stock picking or timing the market. There are even growth funds that select the highest growth companies from the S&P 500. By purchasing a fund such as that, you receive the diversification and the stable companies that are found within the index, but you only own the fastest growers. A fund such as Vanguard's S&P 500 Growth Fund holds 283 growth stocks that are chosen from the S&P 500. But more than half of the fund's allocation are technology companies, providing the opportunity for excellent growth with a little higher risk. You also have exposure to all other sectors held within the index, but with smaller amounts of utilities, real estate, financials, and others that grow at a slower rate. From 2009 to 2019, the S&P 500 return was just under 14%. While that's not bad for a bull market period, it doesn't keep pace with growth stock funds. Even in a bull market year like 2019, the S&P 500 return was a little better than 31%, while the best growth stock funds were returning more than 40%. Although more aggressive growth funds will perform worse during bear markets, the long-term returns will be higher. Overall, giving up a few percent of the return creates a long-term growth gap. Some funds underperform the S&P 500, and generally you want to stay far away from those. But there are many other funds out there that outperform the index and with reasonably low risk. As always, what the best investments are depend on your age, how much money you have, when you plan on retiring, and a variety of other factors. Regardless, owning the S&P 500 can be a great place to park money for those who don't know much about investing or who are just beginning to invest and haven't explored all of their options. Generally, if you'll be investing for a long period of time, it's recommended to go with something a little more aggressive, provided it's properly diversified, holding a variety of companies of different sectors.